right. Good morning, everyone. Good morning. Good morning. I am your substitute preacher for today, Mr. Cho. We're testing you on the sermon. Listen very carefully. Schneeble is the name. Remember School Rock? No, no one got that. Okay. Sorry, I tried too hard. In case we haven't met, my name is Eugene Cho. I am a friend of mission, and it's always a pleasure to be able to come here on a regular basis to be able to teach with your teaching team from the Holy Scriptures. As you saw from the bumper, we are beginning the series on the book of Acts. And so today we're going to be reading a scripture passage that might be somewhat familiar. We preached on this a few months ago, and it's often the passage in the scripture that preachers and churches often use to describe the early church, the beginning of the movement. So if you have your Bibles with you, Acts chapter 2, verses 42 to 47 is our reading for today, and then we're going to be hopping around in some other places. Friends, listen now for the word of the Lord. They devoted themselves to the apostles' teaching and to fellowship, to the breaking of bread and to prayer. Everyone was filled with awe at the many wonders and signs performed by the apostles. All the believers were together and had everything in common. They sold property and possessions to give to anyone who had need. Every day, they continued to meet together in the temple courts. They broke bread in their homes and ate together with glad and sincere hearts, praising God and enjoying the favor of all the people. And the Lord added to their number daily those who were being saved. Gracious God, thank you again so much. We don't want to take the joy and privilege of gathering together as the church for granted. God, I pray for every ear, every mind, every heart, even every single body that's here, for those who are joining us online. And we pray for the presence and power of the Holy Spirit to be present with us. God, may the words of my mouth and the meditations of our hearts be pleasing in your sight. And all God's people said, amen, amen. When we talk about the beginning of the movement, the beginning of the church, again, Acts chapter 2, Christians and pastors, our tendency is we look at the book of Acts and we identify it as the beginning of the church. And not truly an artist, but if we say the beginning of a church, our tendency is to draw a physical building. And when you think about a church today, you probably think about your home church. I think about my home church. I think about the church that I've pastored over the last 30 years as local church pastors, whether it be in Flushing, New York. I was a youth director in Carmichael, Sacramento, California. I was a pastor in Seoul, Korea for a couple years, and then for many years in Seattle. So certain things about those churches come to mind for me. At the church in Korea, it was a church of about 25,000 people when I was there. It's since grown to about 75,000 people by God's grace. It was this humongous red brick building. And we had like small cell groups meet all over the place. And when I think about the church in Seattle, it was the largest Protestant building in the city of Seattle. It was a mammoth, formerly used warehouse for like mechanics and garage. It was transformed, and we purchased it from another church. It had an amazing sound system in this church building. When I think about the church in Sacramento, California, it was just hot in the summer. That's all I remember. So I suspect that when you think about church, it's probably, maybe for some of you, elements about the building. Like when I think about mission, in part I think about these amazing design chairs. Like these are more comfortable than any movie theater seats that I've ever been to. I think about the drummer and the lights and all of these things. And you and I also know that in the beginning of the movement of the church, there was no building. There were no spotlights. There were no comfortable chairs as you're enjoying yourself right now. None of those things existed, and I'm not suggesting that these are all bad, not at all. I think it's good, as they're conducive to us engaging in ministry and worship, but I want you to know that in the beginning of the church, there was no building, and in fact, what we're reminded of is the church is about a group of people that gather together. And if you go back just one few verses earlier in the beginning of chapter 2, really what the book of Acts is all about is the power and the presence of the Holy Spirit. It was the Holy Spirit. Remember, Acts chapter 2, verses 1 to 4, listen to what it says. When the day of Pentecost came, I'm going to stop you for a second. This should not have been necessarily a surprise. Because Jesus himself told the disciples that he promised the gift of the Holy Spirit. They weren't quite sure what to prepare for, but Jesus promised them, you'll never be alone. You'll never be alone. God's gonna give you the gift of the Holy Spirit. So Acts chapter 2, verses 1 to 4, when the day of Pentecost came, they were all together in one place. Suddenly a sound like the blowing of a violent wind came down from heaven and filled the whole house, where they were sitting. They saw what seemed to be tongues of fire that separated and came to rest on each of them. All of them were filled with the Holy Spirit and began to speak in other tongues as the Spirit enabled them. So friends, you go back to Acts chapter 2, we see certainly all of the stories of Scripture in the Old Testament leading to the arrival of the Messiah, Jesus Christ. Jesus Christ crucified, risen again by the power of God. And now in the beginning of Pentecost, there's about 120 people. They're just basically waiting for the gift of the Holy Spirit. And yes, just as Jesus said, the Holy Spirit comes and boom, the birth of the movement. See, oftentimes I think in our modern lens, if we're not careful, we're gonna look at the church and look at physical, material things. If we're not careful, we end up relying on like charismatic teachers and gifted leaders, and we look at methodology, we look at techniques, and those things have a place. But at any moment when they supersede, when human ego supersedes our reliance and desperate need on the Holy Spirit, then woe unto the church. As adversarial as this may sound, it's not my intent, and I believe that God will always oppose the proud. In some ways, I think there's a major disruption happening, especially in the Western church, because somehow, slowly but surely, we've been seduced by human versions of horses and chariots. And we've lost our sense of desperation and reliance and humility, our dependence on the Holy Spirit. And so when you read Acts chapter 2, as we just did, it's because of what the Holy Spirit does that they gather together and they begin to be devoted to the apostles' teaching, to fellowship, to the breaking of bread and to prayer. In other words, the Holy Spirit begins to weave a sense of rhythm into the movement. Think about what rhythm looks like for you. As human beings, we're all people of some kind of rhythm. So the church also needs a language, it needs rhythms, it needs a reliance, it needs a North Star, Jesus, the Holy Spirit, the triune God. And so they gathered together for these things. Now again, I'm gonna kind of point you to that sermon a few months ago when I taught on this particular passage about the beginning of the church and what it meant. But today, I want to kind of approach this passage from a different perspective, and it's this. That as much as we love Acts 2, 42 to 47, and I hear a lot of people say, why can't the church be like this amazing, perfect church in Acts chapter 2? I often respond and say, well, you should read onward in the book of Acts. If you read onward, what happens? There are complexities and challenges and arguments and disagreements and divisions take place. Why? Because of humans. You've heard me say this many a times. It's probably lost its effectiveness, but you've heard me say, like, the best thing about church is you. The most challenging thing about church is, I'm gonna stop right. No, see, the most challenging thing about church is you. It's me. I have the capacity for beautiful things in my life. Ask my wife. I also have the capacity for some challenging things. Why were you laughing here? Right? All of us do. And so we see this in the book of Acts. But what might be lost is I want you just to take a moment to acknowledge what is taking place in the beginning of the movement. In the beginning of the movement, by the power of God, by the truth of the resurrection, and by the movement of the Pentecost, the gift of the Holy Spirit, human beings that were not meant to be together became together. See, I truly believe as I study the history of the church, while there have been other gatherings of people, while there have been other communities of people, I truly believe there has been nothing like the church, where strangers became dignified and seen and become human, seen as people, women, men, and children created in the image of God. These humans, strangers, become neighbors because Jesus teaches so deeply and profoundly about loving your neighbors. And these human beings begin to see neighbors in a radically subversive way, where those that were seen as enemies or other are now seen through the lens and the power of the Holy Spirit as neighbors. And neighbors become community, and community become family. How else could you describe what we just read? People that had no business being together, and in Acts chapter 2, it says so beautifully, they gathered and ate together with sincere hearts. In our world today, it's not that big of a deal, I guess, to go out for a meal. But I want you to know that in the times of Jesus, when you broke bread with someone, as Jesus did, there was a reason why the religious leaders were just so outraged by Jesus, because he was breaking all of the rules. He was destroying all of the parameters and boxes of what decent behavior for a religious leader looked like. You see, especially for a religious leader, you weren't supposed to be seen in public with people that you were not supposed to be seen with. You weren't supposed to eat with people that were not decent people. Why? Because when you ate together with others, you were signifying to that person, but to others who saw you, that you desired a long, eternal life friendship with that person. That's why in the book of Revelations, Revelation says, see, I stand at the door and knock. You'll open the door, I'll come in, and we will dine together. It's really scandalous. And I have this feeling that in our modern church, we'll look at Acts chapter 2 and we'll just go kind of a nice, polite golf clap. Oh, Ah, it's so nice. I want you to realize this is crazy. It's outrageous. It's scandalous. This is why the Apostle Paul in Galatians chapter 3, verse 28, sometimes I think modern theologians give the Apostle Paul way too much of a difficult time. The Apostle Paul was outrageous. In Galatians chapter 3, he says, there is neither Jew or Greek, slave or free, male or female. Why does he state these binary comparisons? Because that was the worldview of that time. The worldview was you were Jews or Greeks, slaves or free, male or female. And what the Apostle Paul says, inspired by the Holy Spirit, subversive, turn it upside down around. This is God's kingdom. In Christ Jesus, he creates family. This is absolutely radical. They had no business being together. These 120 people had no business being together. If you were an entrepreneur back then and you wanted to gather 12 people to start a business or a movement, you would not have picked those 12 disciples. They were the misfits of misfits. They themselves had conflict and tension. And the list goes on. Jesus, as a rabbi, had no business being with tax collectors, the Samaritan woman, the lepers, and those who were sick. Jesus had no business wasting his precious, important time welcoming children unto himself. Jesus shocked a lot of people. I think if I was there in the crowd, I would have been shocked. You and I might think, no, I get it. No, we would have been shocked. And we ourselves may have said, what kind of rabbi is this? Remember that story when Jesus, this is crazy, he says, Zacchaeus. Whoa, 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 whoa. Stop 1 minute. Did he just befriend a tax collector? I don't know if there was anyone more hated, right? I think it's like, think about all of the people, and then there's like the Patriots fans, and then you've got Zacchaeus. That's how I see it, all right? That's how I see it. But seriously, a tax collector, not only betrayed his people working for the villainous, oppressive Roman Empire, but scholars tell us that tax collectors didn't earn a salary, and they were basically given permission, turn the other eyes, where they could skim and steal from their own people. It wasn't just because tax collectors worked for the other oppressive regime. It was the fact that they were known to be people who were stealing from their own. Are you serious? So when I think about God's grace, when I think about what the power of the Holy Spirit can do you every now and then think to yourself, no, not that person. No. Not her, not him. The only way that this is possible, I've learned, it's not through your power or mine. The only way that forgiveness, reconciliation, the only way that these things, divisions, pain, and conflict could ever have a possibility of redemption is because we've got to go back to this right here. We got to go back to the beginning about Jesus' words, God conquering death through the death and resurrection of Jesus and the gift of the Holy Spirit. So a church can grow in size, it can grow in people, it can grow in productions, but after a while, over time, there's something about growth that challenges our sense of dependence on the Holy Spirit. Can I just flash back for me as a pastor, as a church planter? My wife and I planted this church in Seattle many, many years ago. And it's strange, but I often told our church before I stepped down after about 18 years that even in the early years when, yes, you prayed for a building and you prayed for growth and you prayed for impact, you prayed for these things, and amazing, those things happened by God's mercy and grace. The church went from one service to two services and to three services. We went from a living room to a coffee shop to a larger coffee shop. And we went to built our little small warehouse. And then we had a church that gave us their building. And we were able to purchase this other large building. And next thing you know, we had air conditioning. You're not impressed, but in Seattle, that's a big deal. You would have respected me in Seattle, okay? And after many, many years into that, I remember coming to the church and saying, folks, man, I miss the early years. I miss the early years where everybody had to be involved, where every Sunday we gathered together on our knees and asked for God's mercy and grace and for God's leading and guidance. I miss the early days where everybody had to set up their own chairs and break it down. Everybody. Everybody. So a church can do all of these things, and if it misses out on our utter dependence and desperation of the Holy Spirit, God will not be mocked. So God does an amazing thing in the early church. And that's one of the main points that I want you to understand. God brings together the church and a people comes together. In some ways, you could say theologically that God adopts, God grafts people unto himself. And scripture tells us that God begins to call us, this is crazy, his sons and daughters. And we become heirs to God's inheritance, the gift of eternal life. But the book of Acts, this movement, is not just merely a story of God, the power of the Holy Spirit, birthing the early church. That's part of it. But in addition to it, he begins to give the church, here it is, a mission. Let me pause here just for a second because this is really important. If we stop with Acts chapter 2, if the book of Acts was just Acts 1, 2, and okay, let's include 3. Well, let's go up to 5. 5 also includes some nice stories of the early church, and I suspect we're like, oh man, this is great. If we think that's the totality of God's assignment for us to come together, to be the church, brothers and sisters, gather together, eat with sincere hearts, all very profound. I want you to realize it's super profound. That people who had no business coming together come together and they become a church, a family, a community of people. But when you read on in the movement of the book of Acts, you begin to realize that God's desire for the church wasn't to simply become what I sometimes refer to as the holy huddle or a nice meal. Friends, you should know, man, that was the part that I all really loved about our church. I loved gathering together. We loved, as a multicultural church, we love the multicultural feast. Man, I love the fact that we had like tacos and enchiladas. We had like sushi. We had like Korean marinated barbecue kalbi beef. Clearly, you have not been to a Korean barbecue because there should have been a thunderous applause at that point. But you get my point. I love these things. But the book of Acts And really, the story of the scriptures is a God who's on mission, and theologians often call this the Missio Dei. This is really important that we include not just mission. It's not just your church's mission. It's not just your family mission. It's not just the personal mission. Our mission has to be locked in, formed, informed, transformed by the Missio Dei, the mission of God. So Acts chapter 2, the Holy Spirit breathes fire, inspiration, gathers together, and then Peter preaches, thousands of people come to faith, and as they gather, in order to be on mission, you've got to be together. Or people are rowing in different directions. So the Holy Spirit teaches them rhythms about the early church. And as the Holy Spirit teaches rhythms and they begin to form a sense of family and community, lest they be seduced into stopping right here as a holy huddle. They begin to realize that one of the purposes for us as the church is to reflect God's heart and God's character. And so as we study God's heart, God's character, as we learn about the kingdom of God, right? The kingdom of God, that phrase, the kingdom of God, spoken of, I believe, 77 times in the New Testament. Jesus teaching about the Sermon on the Mount, a sense of ethics of the kingdom of God, subversive to this world. The charge for the church is to reflect God's heart and God's character and then to go into the ends of the earth. Remember Jesus' instructions? When we become way too comfortable here, and I'm just confessing how I feel sometimes, because sometimes the world can be so challenging, I want to form my holy huddle. I want to make sure that our home base is as comfy and as nice and as protective as possible. But we're reminded of Jesus' words when he says, go into the world, Jerusalem, Judea, Samaria. Hello, Samaria. We'll talk about Samaria at a future sermon, but I want you to know about 99% of the population did not travel through Samaria, because it was occupied by those Samaritans, those dirty, contaminated, compromising half-breeds. And then Jesus says, go into the ends of the earth. Today, I want to just talk about one of those things that reflects God's heart. You see, God sees people as his creation, his sons and his daughters. Like, I want you to know how powerful this is. And I don't know if this is a good example, but it's a story that comes to mind. When my wife and I had our first child, her Korean name is Yejin. And her English name is Jubilee. And they both speak about the joy of God. And Jubilee from Leviticus, God erasing all debt every 50 years. And so when Jubilee, Yejin, was born, like all parents, there's a kind of a unspoken game that happens between moms and dads. And the unspoken game is, will the child say dad or mom first? No one wants to name it because it's so unchristian, but we all play that game. And so my wife, Minhee, is looking at Jubi and goes, Jubia, omma, omma, which means mom in Korean. And I'm saying, appa, appa, appa. And so for months, like, we're stunting our kids' development because we're only teaching two words. Omma, appa, omma. And then it happened. Juby says, 엄마. Oh. So I figure in about a week or so, she would come around to saying, 아빠, it doesn't happen. A couple weeks go by, 3 weeks go by, 4 weeks go by, 2 months go by. Now I'm taking it personal. What's going on here? But I'll never forget this. One day, I'm driving back from work, drive into the garage, and I open the garage door leading into the living room. I'll never forget this, never. My daughter, sitting on the ground, turns to the door, hearing me come in. She looks at me and says, 아빠. I just wept. I don't have these moments often, but in that moment, I really sensed the voice of the Holy Spirit saying, Eugene, when you find this much joy hearing your daughter acknowledge that you are her father, how much more joy must God feel over his creation when people know that they are sons and daughters? Amen. So as we're reflecting on God's heart and God's character, part of our mission as the church is to declare, to sing, to preach, to teach, to counsel, to converse over meals, to let people know that God is your father. God desires a relationship with you, but also to acknowledge that in our world that's broken, that's unjust, is to acknowledge that we live in a world where, yes, there are brokenness among friendships and relationships and families, including the reality of the fact that there are so many children and youth and teenagers that are in our foster care system that are waiting to be adopted. My wife, as a counselor, has worked with a foster kind of adoption center for a couple years, some years ago, and some of the stories that she would share were so heartbreaking. And but because as a church, we're called to reflect the heart of God, listen to what it says in Psalm 68:5, a father to the fatherless, a defender of widows is God in his holy dwelling. See, they're beginning to learn that the purpose of the church isn't just this right here. It's not just to gather in rhythms and to enjoy nice meals together. All of it matters. But the purpose of the church is not simply to gather in a circle and to keep doing this really, really well. As we do this, we've got to go. We've got to go and be on mission. Deuteronomy chapter 10, verse 18, he defends the cause of the fatherless and the widow and loves the foreigner residing among you, giving them food and clothing. In a world today that begins to see all of the social ailments only and purely, it feels like, through political eyes or lens, we've got to see things from the lens of the kingdom of God, who gives us the gift of the Holy Spirit and says, be my hands and my feet. In Isaiah chapter 1, verse 17, it says, learn to do right. Learn, because it wasn't the common thing to do. You got to realize, loving orphans during the time of Jesus was not something people saw. Engaging the Samaritan woman with humanity and dignity was not something that people saw. Welcoming the sick and welcoming the lepers was not a common thing to do. And yet the Holy Spirit gives inspiration to the church. If we lose out on the mission of the church, then we're just this. And if we're just this, I'm just gonna be very blunt and candid with you. If we're just this, then what's our purpose? Let's put on a really good show. Let's put on the best show that we can. Let's get some nice lights. Let's get a nice Asian preacher. Thank you for that one applause. If we lose this, I don't think we're the church anymore then. I think we're just a religious social club. See, Isaiah 1:17, learn to do right, seek justice, defend the oppressed, take up the cause of the fatherless, plead the case of the widow. How scandalous it is to acknowledge that in a society, a city, a nation, a world where there are children in need of foster homes or those who might be orphans, to be able to reflect the mercy, kindness, grace of God. This is why I think it's so important that today you'll hear a bit more at your church about some very small but practical next steps to help us with that. As I conclude, I want to encourage you. Let's hear from a couple who took that call to step out in faith to make a difference in foster children's lives. Watch this video.
Hi, my name is Mandy. This is Caleb. We've been going to mission for a little bit over 8 years, and this is our foster care story. We've been interested in doing foster care for several years, and we had talked about it and knew that it was something that God had put on our hearts, but we just didn't really know where to get started and how to get the ball rolling. We decided to attend one of the classes that Mission was a part of, and we walked in there with a lot of questions. I think we walked out feeling really educated and able to make a good decision. Fast forward 6 months later, we got licensed to do foster care. About a month after our license came through in 2020, we got our first placement. So she was a four-year-old little girl. Her name was Izzy. Our kids loved her, we loved her, and it was just feeling like, okay, the ball is rolling, like this is going really well.
We start getting, you know, different kids and placements in our house. It's crazy whirlwind. You know, there's some days and you're thinking, oh my goodness, I'm a certified parent. I'm the best in the world. And then there's other days when you're like, I can't believe anybody lets me have kids. I'm gonna go crazy.
And our next placement was Zoe. And she was this incredible four-year-old little girl. And we had her for a full 15 months. When she first arrived in our care, she didn't know any colors. She didn't know a single letter, a single number. She didn't know any shapes. We were able to spend a lot of one-on-one time with her, get her all caught up so she could start kindergarten on time. And then about 9 months into us having her, we got a call that her biological dad had kind of decided to come onto the scene, and he was gonna start working the process of getting his kids back in his custody. 2 weeks before Christmas of last year, he was able to drive down and pick up all three of his kids and take them home. And the heartbeat of foster care is reunification. That's why we're doing this.
Bottom line, our goal was seeing this happy ending, seeing the idea of a kid getting to be back with their parents.
So we decided to transition from full-time foster care to something that's a little bit more part-time, and it's respite care, where we're able to come in and provide a safe place for these kiddos that are already in foster care, and their families, their foster families just need help. Anywhere from, you know, a day to several weeks, up to a month, they can be with us. And it works out really well for our family, because then when they go home to their foster family, we get a chance to regroup and come back together and kind of resettle.
This is a calling that I'm very grateful that we answered. And again, God is good and God is creative, and we don't know what he has in store tomorrow. We don't know what the story looks like 5 years from now. Our job is to do what God says today. And I'm grateful that we had a chance to do that.
We saw our kids grow throughout this process. We saw them grow in their just their ability to love on somebody else. This is what it looks like to put somebody else first. You know, this is what it looks like to truly not just talk about the Lord, but really try to live your life in a way that honors him. Get some information, take a class, look into it, see where you might fit within the world of foster care, whether it's foster or respite or mentorship, where you can come in and really be a light to these kiddos and support their family and cheering on this idea of reunification and bringing families back together. I just really encourage you to step out in faith and see where God takes you and how he changes you and your family.
Absolutely love the Auburn family. Are they here? Are they here today? 10:30 probably. That's good. I love them. Such a good family. Well, hey, maybe you don't know this, but you are a part of an incredibly generous church that loves to be generous in loving our community. And one of the ways we do that around here, it's really been a history and a staple point of this church, is by loving these children in our community. I was reminded this morning, my daughter's soccer game, club soccer game last night was rained out, and so they had to do PKs this morning. It was bright and early, we showed up, and all we do is PKs, and my daughter drilled hers. It was awesome. I was cheering so loud for that moment, but it just reminded me how proud I am of her. And she had a moment where she was running back to her team, and I just caught a glimpse of her eye looking over at me, and what she wanted is she just wanted to be reminded that her dad was proud of her. And I just think about these 14,000 kids in the state of Arizona that are a lot like our own kids. They want to be seen. They want to be known. They want to be loved. They want to belong. And what I love about this church is the history of this church is there's not a Sunday that I don't stand out in that courtyard where I watch many of these children running across our campus, loving and laughing, going to learn about Jesus, seeing the Auburn's families make a difference in our community. And that's what you're invited into, to be a part of that. And so for today, what we want to encourage you in is just to take a small step in that. And so in 2 weeks, on October 23rd, from noon to 2, free childcare is involved. Just come and learn and participate and hear what it looks like to be a church that generously loves not only the next generation, but our community. Not only these kids in our house, but these kids in our community. And I can tell you right now, that's part of my wife and our family story. And it's just such a beautiful way that God will show up in your life and reveal himself to you. And then I just want to encourage you to come back next week because Pastor Landon is going to continue in the Acts series. He's got 5 monumental truths about Jesus Christ. And you're not going to want to miss it. Have a great week, everybody. We'll see you next week.
Have you been praying and you still have no answer? Have you been pouring out your heart for so many years? Have you been hoping that things would have changed by now? Have you cried all the faith you have through so many tears? Don't forget the things that he has done before. And remember he like the brightest sunrise, waiting on the other side, on the darkest night. Don't ever lose hope, hold on and believe. Maybe you just haven't seen it, just haven't seen it yet. You're closer.